inside is on this section of the
Health. Welcome to another episode of the Resh Hour with yours truly, Resh Hour. Right, I'm here at the campus tonight. I am very pleased to have our guest,
the
president.
Was in planning, and some of those are coming up very soon to alleviate traffic routes, so you don't have to be full time. But we still will be dealing with a little bit of that traffic.
Good afternoon, Cayman Islands, and welcome to another episode of the Resh Hour with yours truly, Reshma Raghunath. I'm very pleased to welcome to our show today National Epidemiologist Rachel Corbett. Rachel, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi, you're welcome. It's great to be here.
All right, so Rachel, I want to start first with a little bit about your background and what a National Epidemiologist does. So let's start there first with, tell me a little about yourself.
Sure. So I got into public health and epidemiology when I studied my master's. This was in London. I was really interested in how diseases spread, and I really enjoyed looking at data. So I studied a master's in the control of infectious diseases. And it was from there that I got into working in public health and epidemiology. I've worked in the UK public health body. It's now called UK Public Health Security Body. And I worked there for about 8 years in different teams, doing some national work, doing some regional work, and in different, looking at different types of diseases and working on their surveillance. So that's where we kind of monitor data, we gather data from different healthcare centres around the country to keep an eye on what's going on. Some of this work was in sexual health and HIV. Some of this work was looking at infections among injecting drug users. So it was quite wide ranging. And then when I worked more regionally, we'd kind of cover all diseases that were happening in that population and trying to provide technical and epidemiological input to guide what's going on and inform people working in that sector, as well as monitoring and supporting for outbreaks. So when we have kind of a cluster of cases or you can see an outbreak starting, you'll gather a multidisciplinary team together and try and understand what's going on. And from a public health perspective, what measures you need to put in place to stop it spreading and to control the situation. So that's a lot of what my work has been in the past, particularly pre-COVID.
Mm-hmm. I was just about to ask you, COVID changed that, didn't it?
Everything, as you all know, changed very quickly. Mm-hmm. I was also involved in some different pieces of international work in my background. And so when COVID hit and we were trying to understand it, I got quite involved with our international team in the UK as part of the national response. So we were gathering data around what was happening in different countries around the world. So right from the beginning, clocking which countries even were reporting their first cases, and over time building a data set to understand the cases and deaths and hospitalizations in all different countries. And a lot of that intelligence gathering was to help us see what impact was happening elsewhere and to guide our response by learning from other countries. And I went on to lead a particular team in that, looking at travel risk. So individuals in the UK, if they were, when measures lifted, if they were travelling abroad, either for holiday or visiting friends and relatives, what risk they were facing being in another country as mm-hmm. compared to being in the UK. So it was very interesting work. It was quite challenging. In some instances, there's not much data to work with from some countries. You're always looking at what's been publicly reported mm-hmm. and trying to piece things together and understand the situation there. So it was a great experience in seeing how different countries work and how their responses differ and what information they were publishing and trying to technical briefings for our government in the UK.
Interesting. What was it like at the epicenter? Because the UK was among the first countries to record COVID cases early in the pandemic. What was it like working in that kind of environment?
With so many
unknowns.
Yeah, of course. It was fascinating. It was very fast-paced, very dynamic. Multiple times during the day, things would shift, a new vital piece of information would come in, and priorities would change, and you had to be very reactive and proactive. You had to be very flexible just to work with what was happening. It was an amazing time in one sense to see everyone come together and to learn with everyone at the same time. It was also quite scary that we were learning just as much as we were telling the public. You know, you like to be able to have a good solid understanding of things when you're then speaking to the public, and sometimes you were acting on small amounts of information, having to make decisions on that. So seeing colleagues do that, it was a really amazing learning opportunity to see how you handle those situations and emergencies.
Wow. In your time during that period of investigation and learning the epidemiological trends, did you interact with Cayman at all before you joined the team last year?
I interacted with our, in the UK we have a global health team, and they support all of the UK overseas territories. So I actually interacted with the individual who was leading that at the time, who was our interim CMO, actually, Ottilia Newton. So I had a lot of contact with Ottilia before I came out and met her here in person. Mm-hmm. She was able, from her correspondence with people on the ground, she was able to share some of what was going on when we would be putting together a briefing on different UCOTs or Cayman particularly. So I did have some insights then, but I had no idea I would be here years later.
Yeah, isn't it serendipitous?
It is.
I mean, you were dealing with, you know, people like John Lee and Dr. Newton and you know, the team down here on the ground, and then now you're here.
I am, full circle.
Exactly. So tell me, what does a national epidemiologist do? Because this is a new role. I know there was, it was something on the books that they were trying to get up and running for some time. So what exactly is your role and some of the particular functions that comes with it?
So epidemiology is essentially studying the spread of disease. There are kind of three things we always look at when we're looking at information that's based around time, person, and place. So we're trying to understand when, particularly looking at infectious diseases, if there are any links in time, if they're clustering and happening at a similar time, maybe that is the start of an outbreak or something causing that. Are there particular people who are being affected? Is it a particular age group? And place, are they clustered geographically? That might tell you that there's an exposure related to that geographical area, or there's a premises people have visited, and that might be what's causing some of that disease. So those are the things that we look at generally in epidemiology. But the role of, I think, the national epidemiologist, has been a lot of requests around trying to access data. And I think Cayman has a lot of data, but it's not necessarily inaccessible ways. We have quite a diverse health care system here with public and private. Mm-hmm. We don't have a national identifier, so it's quite difficult to then, if you're going to gather those things in, if you would have a way of gathering data from all clinics in that way, to deduplicate it so you don't count people twice can be quite difficult if you haven't got a national identifier. So I think the role is about helping to advise policy from an epidemiological standpoint, health policy. It's also to support and oversee with surveillance and trying to strengthen the surveillance we have here. I think the pandemic showed all around the world that there are gaps in what we're doing and how we're able to react and what information we have. So to really strengthen the surveillance we have here in Cayman for infectious diseases, but also non-infectious diseases, is really important. And to support on outbreaks and things like that as well too.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Now, you mentioned data challenges. We do know, from the many times that we've spoken to our cancer registrar, Amanda Nicholson, that gathering that data is difficult for the cancer registry. So I guess from a more broader perspective, those challenges would, of course, expand. In your duties, have you seen those kind of gaps in getting that data done so that you can effectively fulfill your role?
I think there are definitely challenges in pulling those things together. In Cayman, like many other countries, we have, by law, there's just one form of data, which is the notifiable diseases. These are in a group, a list of infectious diseases which by law need to be reported because they put other people in the population at risk, mm-hmm. because they're contagious and can pass from person to person. So that data and the COVID data are probably the only two sources of national data that we have in Cayman, because we have this split of public healthcare and private. Mm-hmm. We maybe can look at the public healthcare coming through HSA, but that's not representative of the whole population. And I think what we struggle with is we might be able to access some of that, but it won't inform us on people who aren't accessing healthcare, for example, and it also won't inform us on people who are accessing other areas of healthcare. So it gives you a biased skew on what you're looking at. And you mentioned the cancer registry, that's voluntary. So whilst it does give us some information, it's only those that are willing to come forward and to share that. So again, it gives a bias on what that's mm-hmm. telling you, and really we need to understand these things nationally to know for the whole population, and particularly if it's people who aren't accessing healthcare, that's where some of the real challenge will be, is there must be some barriers there, and what can we do to remove those? Yeah. How can we improve our healthcare access? And those might be individuals who are most in need of the care as well in the first place.
Exactly. You know, I guess it boils down to people understanding why it's important to give this data. Why is it so necessary that we have this information? Can you know, maybe shed some light on that? Why is this information so important?
Yeah, I think really it's about being able to provide policy or programs or infrastructure which really meets the need of the population. Mm-hmm. You can have anecdotal ideas of, oh, we think this might be a challenge, or we think this might be a challenge, but you don't know that's necessarily the case until you have the evidence to back it up. Mm-hmm. And that is what we can do with data, and when that's handled appropriately and anonymized as it needs to be in different situations for this. But we need to be making evidence-based decisions, right? We need to be producing policy or healthcare planning, especially planning for the future, which is something particularly important for chronic illness, is that they can last a long time. And if we want, you know, we know that the population here is growing, we know the population is aging, and so that will create a different burden in the future on our healthcare than what we have now. And for us to be able to plan effectively for that, we need to have the data now mm-hmm. to project that forwards and understand how those things can develop.
Exactly, and that speaks to how many doctors we need,
exactly.
how many hospitals, how many nurses, what kind of equipment do we need.
What different specialisms we need.
Yeah. Exactly, so that's key. I want to switch the conversation just to talk a little more about our COVID situation, because we are seeing, and we have been getting reports of people testing positive again. I mean, I'm sure that never stopped, right?
Yeah.
You know, but what are you seeing on the ground in terms of our current COVID situation and the cases that are being reported?
So COVID, like other respiratory infections, does vary by seasons, slightly less here. We've got a warmer climate than other places in the world, but particularly because we've got a lot of transfer of people and mobility, people coming and going to those other countries, we do still see seasonal variations. So as we're coming out of winter, we have seen our markers for COVID decrease. So we're seeing lower rates of individuals hospitalized at the moment and lower numbers of deaths. Those are the two main indicators that we're monitoring at the moment, because there's been the change in testing. Mm-hmm. And now it's not mandated for people to test and report that. Mm-hmm. That information isn't coming through in a standardized way anymore. So it's not really so meaningful to interpret, because mm-hmm. you are missing a lot of those tests. So we now focus mostly on the hospitalizations and the deaths as our main indicators surveillance-wise. And those are just really fluctuating at kind of a low baseline level. Mm-hmm. When people are hospitalized and they test positive for COVID, it could either be that COVID is causing their illness, or it could just be as people are screened when they come into hospitals that they're actually there for a different reason mm-hmm. and they happen to also have COVID, but that's not necessarily causing the hospitalization. So we mm-hmm. just have to be aware of that caveat when we look at those numbers.
Yeah. So how do you tell that differentiation though? Because it's still recorded as a COVID hospitalization.
It's actually very difficult. And at times in the pandemic, we've given a breakdown of whether it was caused from COVID or they happened to have COVID when they came in, but their illness was caused by something else. And for some cases, it's easier to differentiate. But for some cases, it's actually very difficult to know if they're presenting more with respiratory symptoms and presentation that could be COVID, mm-hmm. or COVID could be an underlying cause in other medical illnesses. And so for some, we can't differentiate that. So you can have kind of a proxy, but it's not a direct measure in that same way.
Yeah, and what also adds to that challenge is if you have an autoimmune condition, like I have systemic lupus, so, you know, some of the symptoms might be connected to that, but
yeah.
I don't have COVID, by the way. But you know, just you know, those are some of the factors that also impact that determination as well. But I want to talk a little bit about the strains that we're seeing, because we do know that there is another new strain that is causing some problems in the UK in particular. Have you seen that new Omicron strain here?
As yet, we haven't. What we typically see when there's kind of global reports of a new strain, currently what is circulating is all Omicron. So Omicron is the variant that's been around for a while now and is predominant across the variants that we've seen before. And over time, we've kind of seen a progression of different sub-variants of that, sub-strains. And it's kind of a process of natural variation in the virus that something will develop and it will have a competitive streak over the previous ones and it will start to become dominant. It's quite natural to see that. It's not anything unexpected. So that's really what we've been seeing. So we have seen cases of XBB and XBB 1.5, which were the kind of previous two that were mm-hmm. causing some interest globally, because they were seeing kind of cases of it shoot up quite quickly in the States and in the UK. That really did look to be more that variant just becoming dominant in that kind of natural way that I spoke of. So the current one that you're referring to, XBB 1.16, I believe it is, mm-hmm. looks to be a similar situation, that it's just another kind of sub-variant of Omicron. Mm-hmm. And really just time will tell whether we kind of end up seeing kind of higher reports of mortality or any other concerning picture with it. But as yet, it's just looking to be kind of the next natural evolution of the virus. Mm-hmm. As I say, we've not seen any on Ireland yet, but I wouldn't be surprised in the next month if we do. We typically tend to lag behind other countries reporting in the world. But I expect that it will be on Ireland at some point, and
that's just how it goes.
Yeah,
like.
It's not of a particular concern at the moment.
Exactly. I have to say I'm impressed that you remember all the numbers together of these strains.
It's been difficult, yeah.
Well, good on you then. So as we, you know, you're saying that we're going to expect this, I want to touch on what's happening with the booster program, because, you know, the ministry has been, and Dr. Jenta and yourself have been talking about the booster program and getting boosted, but the uptake still remains low. You know, what is happening with the program? Are there any plans to change the focus or, you know, maybe even end the program altogether given the numbers that you're seeing?
At the moment, I think the plans are for the program to continue as it is there to provide the booster to those who are kind of most at risk. And we really want to be able to prevent what the vaccine is brilliant at is preventing hospitalizations and preventing deaths. And so we really want to ensure that those that are most at risk in the population, those maybe that are elderly or have underlying conditions like you talked about previously as well, mm-hmm. That they have access to what they need. So the booster program will continue for now. There may be a time in the future where that's reviewed and that's changed in line with how we roll out other vaccines on Ireland, but at the moment it's continuing.
Okay. Now, you know, why are we not offering the vaccine to children under 12? Because some countries are offering it. I think the UK has started non-vaccine boosters for the 12 and under age group. Are we looking to offer that here as well?
I don't believe we are at the current time, but it's offered from those that are 12 plus for the vaccine, yeah.
Okay. You know, there is some who say in the community that almost everybody's had COVID, there's natural immunity in the community, and then we have a section of the community that's already been boosted, so why bother getting the booster itself? What do you say to those who, you know, have that kind of thinking?
Well, I think with the vaccines, we've definitely seen that after a period of time, the immunity that's vaccine-derived does start to wane. So that's why we've been having these boosters, partly to boost that immunity as it wanes over time. But also as the different variants have come out, we've been able to, some of the latest vaccines can then target the Omicron variant particularly. We know it's reacting to what's spreading in the population rather than the original strain of the virus. So that's also been an important part of it. And I think it's just making sure that if you are at greater risk, that you make sure that you're protected, and it's a tool there to be used for that.
Okay, great. Now, part of your role is looking at local health trends and so forth, and breaking down where policy focus should be on in combating, for example, non-communicable diseases. And I know there is the SEPS survey that is happening right now, and we're going to get into some detail on that particular survey. But before we talk about the survey, I want to talk a little bit about the trends that you've been seeing since you've been on the ground looking at the available data, and you know, health-wise, what that assessment looks like. So what are some of the key trends that you're seeing in the community in terms of the health conditions?
Yeah, well, non-communicable diseases is definitely an area where we have, I'd say, patchy data currently. So it's definitely piecing together different bits of the puzzle to try and get an understanding. We have a few different sources of data we can look at. We've got the STEPS survey that was done in 2012, so we have the results from then. And that gives us a few different indications. For example, at that time, 70% of the population were either obese or overweight. 15% of the population were current smokers, 40% of the population had raised blood pressure, and 15% of those had raised blood pressure but weren't on medication at the time. So that gives you a good point where you know, well, we can act here and have big impacts. We can ensure those people are receiving the right medication that they need. Maybe they're not unaware, maybe they are unaware that they have raised blood pressure, maybe they haven't been able to access care for that. So those were some of the markers that the previous survey told us. And then since then, we do have a few other pieces of data, so we can look at mortality data. Obviously, this doesn't reflect people living with conditions in the community, and it really just talks about what causes death, so it's the main cause of disease. But we do know in Cayman that essentially cardiovascular illness is the main cause of disease. And so that's something that we can look at trying to reduce through looking at the risk factors that people have for that, which is something that the survey gathers information around. And then we also have other information coming from things like the census. So they had a helpful question in the recent census around medically diagnosed illness that leads to disability. So this is really asking about people, you know, in your everyday life, are there conditions that you have that make daily activities difficult? And a few conditions that were mentioned there that kind of came up with the highest occurrence were diabetes, arthritis, cataracts. So we know these are conditions that people are concerned about. But it doesn't, all those pieces of information kind of give you part of the picture, and they aren't telling you the national prevalence, for example, of diabetes or the national prevalence of obesity we had from 2012, but we've not had in a long time. So that's really
kind of outdated.
A little. So that's really why we're looking to do the survey, is to fill that gap, to provide updated estimates, and to do that nationally so that we know that it represents all of the Cayman Islands. And doesn't miss people by only looking at data that comes through healthcare facilities, for example. So that's, yeah, that's why we're looking to do this.
Okay, interesting. Now, we're going to have to take a quick check-in with the news headlines, but I want to get into the actual survey itself and the mechanics of it. So we're going to take a quick check-in with headlines and come back after this.
Thank you.
Okay, we continue our conversation with National Epidemiologist Rachel Corbett. Now, before we took that brief headline break, we were talking about local health trends, and we were talking about, you know, diabetes and a cardiovascular disease. But we've also flagged childhood obesity as a problem as well here. Do you think that parents and students themselves are, you know, being reached sufficiently with information to help them, address these kinds of non-communicable diseases so that we don't get to that point?
Yeah, so I think when you're talking about non-communicable diseases, these are things which can impact across the lifespan. They can take quite a while to develop, and they often do result from lifestyle choices and behaviors. And so when thinking about kind of how we address this across the lifespan, it is really important to think about where we start with children and young adults, particularly as well in the population, when they're forming their own decision making and choosing how they want to live. Mm-hmm. Making sure that we provide them with the information they need to make informed choices is really important. And you mentioned school children as well. We do have a great school health program, so we do have data coming in from across all of the schools in Cayman Islands. And what we can see is when children start in school grade entry from the last year of data, so looking at 22 to 23 intake, when they started in school, around 26% of the children were either overweight or obese. And then in year six, by the time they leave school, that number had gone up to 40%. So you can see even just within the start of child's life in kind of their school years, that is an increasing trend. And it also offers you almost a captive audience. You have them in school. How can we work with schools to be able to try and address this and try and prevent progression of this later in life? We can think about, I know there's been the government school meals program, and we can look at the nutrition in that. We can also look at increasing physical activity in schools and education. But I think it is important to recognise this isn't just the responsibility of schools, this is everyone's responsibility. And that's very much true when you're looking at chronic illness. It's something which, if we're going to take action, it needs to be across government, across the private sector and communities and families. It's really a mandate for all. Just changing something in one area isn't really going to be enough to address it.
Yeah, I mean, I'm surprised by that 26%. I mean, and then by the end of the school year, 40. I mean, that must be concerning to see.
It is very concerning. Sadly, it's not unusual. It's not too different from what you see in the US. But it is very much concerning, it's difficult then to understand if a child starts off in life at that point. You know, it's harder. It's putting a barrier up for them for progressing. And there are different impacts that could have for the children as well. You know, their attendance at school could be affected, or they could put them at higher risk of other health issues, of breathing problems and things like that. So it is really important that we find ways to try and reduce this, try and help schools and teachers and parents and the children themselves as well to understand this more and to see how it can change.
Yeah, and make more healthy choices.
Exactly.
As well.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's talk about the STEPS survey.
Yes.
So first of all, what is STEPS?
That's a good question.
That's an acronym, right?
It's actually not an acronym.
It's
which
not.
I think confuses a lot of people, myself included, when I first heard that. I know. It stands for Stepwise. So it's a survey that the World Health Organization designed, something that can be used around the world in a standardized way. So everyone's collecting the data using the same approach, which means that we can then compare the data we gather with other countries, because we've used the same method. We've asked the same questions.
Yes.
And the Stepwise refers to basically the fact there are different parts to it. It's no more complicated than that. So there are three parts. Step one is a questionnaire. So we'll have a team of interviewers in the community approaching the households that have been selected to take part, and they'll have a questionnaire to fill out. And it includes some general demographic information. It includes information about different risk factors, so people's diet choices, exercise, tobacco use, alcohol use. It includes some questions around accessing healthcare services and using things like preventative screening. So how recently did you have this screening done? Mm-hmm. And one example is a question around, you know, your oral health. When did you last see a dentist? Those kind of questions. And then there is also a second part that happens with the interviewer, which gathers some basic in-home measurements, so things like height and weight. So that means we can look at things like obesity. Also gathers their blood pressure and then their waist and hip circumference. And those last two measures are done by the participant themselves. The interviewer isn't touching their bodies in any way. So that's the second step. And then the final step is an appointment that the individual would have with a nurse. It's to do a finger prick blood drop, and then we can use that to test for blood glucose, to look at kind of risk for diabetes and also blood cholesterol. Those are fasting measurements, so that's why it's done at a separate time. So we'd ask an individual to either come to one of our district clinics or a location on island in the morning, kind of between 7 and 9, or if they rather, we can arrange for a nurse to come back to their home and do a home appointment, again, similar time of the morning. And it's very quick. They just provide one finger drop of blood. The machine reads all the tests at the time. So it just takes 10 to 15 minutes. And that's the third step. And that's the survey.
Okay, so has it already started?
Not yet.
You started gathering data?
So this starts in June. So Saturday the 3rd of June is the launch date, and it runs through June and July.
So how will this survey work? Is it like the census? Because, you know, am I going to have to expect someone at my door? What are the actual mechanics of this survey?
So we look at a sample of the population. So we're looking to approach 3,300 individuals, so it's not everybody. And those individuals will be randomly selected. That's the best way to have representative data nationally and not introduce bias through your own selection process. And so these households will be approached and invited to take part, and one person in the house is invited to take part, so it's not the whole household like the census is. But it's voluntary. The individual doesn't have to. They're not required by any law to take part. We're really just asking people to get involved. If they don't want to or are unavailable to take part, and we'll try and visit a couple of times at convenient times, but if they're unavailable to take part, we won't replace that individual with somebody else. So that's why we're really keen to ask people and encourage people to take part, because if lots of people don't want to and drop out, we won't be able to gather enough information for this to be representative of all of the Cayman Islands.
Okay. Is it happening across all three islands or in Grand Cayman only?
No, all three islands, including Brac and Little, because we want, again, those to be represented in the data.
So you said it's not mandatory, but, you know, a lot of people have concerns about data protection and how their data is stored, what it's going to be used for. So talk to us about the data protection aspect of it. You know, is it going to be anonymous? Are you going to, I mean, you're taking some metrics of health checks, right? So tell me what does that look like?
Sure, so this is an aspect which is really important to the ministry. And so we've been taking a lot of care to make sure that we get this right. And there are two things partly to be aware of. One is that it does collect personal information. So we do ask individuals' names and their date of birth. So in the data they provide at that moment, they are identifiable because they're asking for their name. And the reason for that is so that we can match up the answers and the results from steps one and two with the result from step three, because they're happening on two different occasions. We need to be able to link that together in our data set. So the data is collected on an app, on a tablet, and so it's held in that app at the time. And this is one aspect which we did go through the Data Protection Act to make sure that this aligned to that, and there's a principle in there about international transfer of data. So the data in the app is stored in the EU, which is viewed as a location that has equivalent protection and standards of data management as the Cayman Islands, so that is acceptable for the Data Protection Act. But once the data has been collected, the ministry will download the data and be stored in the Ministry of Health and Wellness. It will be removed from the app. And at that time, we can link the two parts together. Once we've linked them, we will remove all individuals and patient identifiers. There won't be any names in there. We won't be able to work out an individual is from their record. So it will at that point be anonymized when it's stored here in the Cayman Islands. And it has enabled us, as I say, to do that link between the different parts of the data. So what is stored here long term is anonymized. It will only be accessible by less of a handful or less of a couple of individuals in the ministry. That's another important part of data protection, is minimizing who can access to it, right? So that is another step that we're taking. But then also in how we report the data. We will provide a full report of the results, but the data will be aggregated in that report. So it will be grouped together with hundreds of people. Mm-hmm. We will say, you know, this could be the prevalence of obesity in women, but that will be all women who have taken part in the survey, which hopefully will be with thousands of people. So there's no way that you can identify one person's record in that. And that is the approach that we'll take with any data that is reported from the survey.
Okay, so what is the data going to be used for? Like, how are you going to apply that data?
Yeah, so that's a really great question. And as I say, we'll produce a report and we'll produce a fact sheet, and we really want these to be accessible to everyone in Cayman, to residents, people that have taken part in the survey, so they can see where that's all gone. And our desire is for them this to be used for policy. It definitely will be used for health policy in our ministry, but also for other ministries to use. Health is an aspect that affects everyone. It affects your workforce and how much people are able to take part in that. So it affects the business of Cayman Islands, looking at how we use land use and how we can make our population healthier in terms of how we do exercise and what green space there is or what walking areas. You know, this really has impact across all aspects of government. So we're hoping that the results of the survey will be used to inform policy and decision making going forwards, both in health but broader than that. But it will definitely will be guiding our public health interventions and programs in the future to be able to ensure people have access to what they need, particularly with education and particularly with informing people, as you were mentioning earlier, to make good informed choices.
Okay. Now, you said the entire survey runs from June 3rd to
July the 30th.
July the 30th.
So it's an 8-week window, yeah.
Okay, an eight weeks. So how soon can we anticipate getting the full results or the report from that survey? Do you have like a deadline that you're working with to produce it?
We're hoping that the full report will be ready for the end of the year. Hopefully we'll have preliminary results in the autumn time. The August will be when we're starting to look at the data. Mm-hmm. So maybe October, November time, we're hoping to have some preliminary results. But yeah, by the end of the year, we should have everything.
Okay,
published.
So no holiday for you in summer?
Apparently not, no.
What timing is that? Okay, so we are running out of time, and I just want to give you an opportunity. I know there are some meetings that are coming up to help advise the community about the STEP survey and what they can expect as well from that. So tell us a little bit about that before we wrap up.
Yes, we've been heading out into each district to give people an opportunity to come and chat to us, to hear a bit about it, for us to answer any questions they might have. So this week, so tomorrow evening, we're in West Bay. We'll be in the primary school from 6:30 to 7:30. So if anyone wants to come and hear a bit more about the survey, meet some of us and ask any questions, we'd love to see you there. Even if you don't live in West Bay, you're still very welcome. And next week will be the final one in Georgetown for Grand Cayman. So next Thursday will be the Mary Miller Hall, 6:30 again, next Thursday, and then we'll also be heading over to the Sister Islands later in May to meet there too.
Okay, now I'm just curious, the individuals who will be selected for the survey, will they be contacted beforehand to make them aware that they are part of the survey, or how is that?
So when the interviewers are in the community, that will be the first contact. So likely they'll approach the door and just explain a bit about the survey. Mm-hmm. And it might be that someone in the household, is the individual that's selected, is willing to take part then and there. They might want to think about it. We'll have a fuller information sheet that they'll be given, and they can go away and think about it and maybe arrange a convenient time to come back if they are then interested in taking part.
All right, no problem. Thank you so much, Rachel, for all of that and for joining us today. Any final thoughts before we say good afternoon today?
Pleasure. No, it's been great to be here and just really have appreciated everyone's support of the work that we're doing so far. And we're just going to encourage people to get involved as much as they can, talk about it. Part of this is just having the conversation and making health something that we're thinking about and talking about. So really appreciate your time for that.
All right. Thank you so much. And as per usual, before I let you go, I leave you with your inspirational thought for the week. And this one comes from Martin Luther King. We must accept finite disappointment, but we must never lose infinite hope. All right, so that's your inspirational thought, Cayman, as we say good afternoon here on the Resh Hour. On behalf of myself and my director, Andrel Harris, thank you so much for tuning in. We will see you next week, same time and same place, right here on the Resh Hour. Good afternoon.